Isaiah 9:2. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell on the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. Isaiah 9:6 through 7. For unto us a child is born, and to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice, from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way.
Luke 1:26 through 33 and 38. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came into her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled as a saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said to her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou wilt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great. He shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her.
Amen.
Luke 2, 1 through 5. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. Luke 2, 6 through 7. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Capture the wind on the water. How do you count all the stars in the sky. How can you measure the love of a mother? And how can you write down a baby's first cry? Candlelight, angel light, firelight and star glow, shine on his cradle till breaking of dawn. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo, angels are singing, the Christ child is born. Shepherds and wise men will kneel and adore him. Seraphim round him their vigil will keep. Nations proclaim him their Lord and their Savior, but Mary will hold him and sing him to sleep. Candlelight, angel light, firelight and star glow, shine on his cradle till breaking of dawn. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo, angels are singing, the Christ child is born. Find him at Bethlehem, laid in a manger, Christ our Redeemer asleep in the hay. Godhead incarnate and hope of salvation, a child with his mother, that first Christmas day. Candlelight, angel light, firelight and star glow, shine on his cradle till breaking of dawn. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo, angels are singing, the Christ child is born.
Luke 2, 8 through 12. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger."
Angels are singing their song.
Luke 2:13-14. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men."
Somewhere over
Luke 2:15-20. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph, and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Mary knew. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, and it was told unto them.
John 1:1-14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came for testimony, to bear witness to the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to bear witness to the light. The true light that enlightens every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world knew him not. He came to his own home, and his own people received him not. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth, and we have beheld his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father.
Have you ever had a dream, and I'm talking about when you were asleep, when that was so real, it's so vivid, that not only in the dream did it feel like it was reality, but when you woke up, it changed how you saw reality, or it changed how you, even maybe even changed your reality itself. When I was a kid, I had a dream, I was probably about kindergarten or first grade, and I had a dream that I had these stilts. Now, I don't know why I dreamt about stilts. I don't think I wanted them in particular, but in this dream, I had these stilts, and I was going all over the place with them, and it was so cool. And I was convinced that it was real. And in fact, in the dream, I had put them aside near the kitchen, and I had gone to do something, and then when I woke up, I rushed to the kitchen to find those stilts, and they weren't there, and I was so disappointed that this dream that seemed so real wasn't in fact true. And today in our story, we read about Joseph, we hear about Joseph who had a dream that did change how he perceived reality. Joseph, I think sometimes we don't spend a lot of time talking about. He gets lost in the shuffle with Mary and the angels and the shepherds and the birth of God in the person of Jesus Christ. And I sometimes think he gets a little bit of a short deal, but this story is very powerful. He was betrothed to Mary, and in those days, you got engaged at a very young age. Usually, it was arranged marriage between fathers of households, to strengthen that bond, and it was beneficial for both. And so you were actually engaged as a small child. And then later, as you got closer to being of marrying age, then they called it betrothed. And then finally, you would be, usually that'd last about a year, and then you were married. So this is where we find Joseph and Mary in the story, that they are now betrothed. They have been promised to each other for a long time, and now finally they're getting close to being married for real. And now Mary's pregnant. And so Joseph, if he were to follow the rules of his culture, the Jewish rules, Mary would be stoned for being an adulterer because she was pregnant and he knew he didn't do it. But he was an honorable man and he didn't want that to happen to her. So he thought, well, I'll just let her go quietly away. So really that was quite a merciful thing that he was doing. But then he has this dream where God sends a messenger, an angel to him, and to reveal God's plan. And so when Joseph wakes up, he didn't just write it off as to some weird dream, you know, I had some bad falafel or something, but he actually said, I'm going to do what God has called me to do, that this dream has changed his perception of reality. And we see similar things. Later in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, we see the very same Peter who denied Jesus on his death, you know, the night of his death, three times. After he's witnessed the resurrected Christ, after the day of Pentecost, he stands before the Jewish people who has persecuted Jesus, and he calls them out in this very powerful sermon. And in that sermon, he says, because remember the people said, the disciples are all drunk, right? They're speaking in weird languages and things. And he says, no, we're not drunk. We are fulfilling the prophecy that the prophet Joel had said, that we are prophesying and we are having visions and we are having dreams. And we are entering into an age of dreams where people will dream God's dreams and those dreams will come true. And then this is a theme that Martin Luther King Jr. touched upon. So when he gave his famous I Have a Dream speech, this is that same thing that he was keying into, that my dream, it wasn't just his dream, it was God's dream. I had a dream basically of God's dream. And then that powerful sermon has repercussions, you know, even today. That's affected the course of our culture, of our society. You know, it's changed our reality. And even to this day, often there are Muslims during the season of Ramadan, the month of Ramadan, they actually pray that God would reveal himself to them. And there are many, many, many Muslims who have visions of Christ during the month of Ramadan. So when they're trying to be better Muslims, they actually have an experience with the risen Christ and they come to faith. And so dreams have great power. And so during this Christmas season, I encourage you to tap into that faith, that feeling of love and joy and peace and hope that God has for all of the world. This dare to dream big dreams. Whatever dream you have, it's small compared to the kind of dreams that God has. Have you noticed when angels first appear on the scene, they always say one thing first. What do they say? They say, fear not. And I think partly because the angels themselves are powerful, intimidating beings, but I think also they're kind of saying, don't be afraid, but I'm about to tell you one of God's big dreams. He said, the angel appears to Mary and says, fear not, and you, God has a plan for you. And then the angel appears to Joseph in a dream and says, fear not. And the angel appears before the shepherds and says, fear not. And so hopefully this Christmas season you will have an encounter with the risen God and you will fear not. And you will not be afraid to dream those big dreams, to reflect, to search, and to dream. To dream, as our choir is saying, of that joyous day to come. Eternal God, by the birth of Jesus Christ, you gave yourself to the world. Grant that being born in our hearts, he may save us from our sins and restore us with the image and likeness of our Creator, to whom be everlasting praise and glory, world without end. Amen.